Good morning, Lighthouse Church. Hey, I'm so glad to see all of you, and let me tell you, Brian, you were right. There was an anointing over our worship this morning. It's always exciting to worship our Lord and Savior, but as worship leaders and as pastors, it is so much more exciting when we hear you lifting your voices and worshiping our Lord and Savior. And we got to hear that today. Yesterday was super, super special. Not just because it was Halloween. It was super special because last night we got to minister to our community. I believe we probably had close to 1,000 people come through this place. And I'm so thankful that we had that many people. But another thing that made it special was all of you as volunteers saying, hey, let us be the hands and feet of Jesus. Let us serve the community that we love. Another thing that made it special was it wasn't just our church. We had other churches here. The Hartford City Wesleyan Church joined us, and we were just super excited. We love the local church. As a church, I want to encourage you to pray for all of our churches. Let's love on all of our churches. May they grow and may they reach people that need Jesus. So yesterday was a super exciting day. We had such an amazing opportunity in serving. But there's something else that's special about yesterday. In fact, to give you a little history, October 31st, 1517, in Wittenberg, Germany, Martin Luther nailed to the church door his 95 theses. And so today is known for many across our nation as Reformation Sunday. It's where the Protestant church came out of, thanks to Martin Luther. So I thought, in honor of my Sunday school class, which we talked about this a little earlier, they're already laughing. And in honor of Martin Luther, I'd share one of my favorite Martin Luther quotes. So if you have your pens, you might want to get them out because you're going to want to share this quote as well. I resist the devil, and often it is with a fart that I chase him away. One of our spiritual fathers, there's some wisdom in that. Just saying, if you're a little gassy, maybe you're doing a little spiritual warfare. You just got it. Ed just tooted. In our Sunday school class, I had a gentleman say, man, I'm a real warrior then. Hey, thank you for being here with us this morning. We launched a new series last week. It's just going to be a few weeks long. It's called Stories That Will Scare the Hell Out of You. And we're looking at some of these stories in Scripture that are just like, why are they even in there? These are like crazy stories that we didn't realize were in Scripture. And last week I said, listen, over the next several weeks, these are really rated R messages. So I just want to give that warning. If you have a young one in here, today's story is, it's rather gruesome. In fact, I don't think anyone would go to the movies and actually watch this story. Well, maybe some of you, but the average person wouldn't even think about going and watching if this was a movie. And I want to give you a little bit of background. Today's message is simply called this, Boiled Alive. Boiled Alive. I want to give you a little bit of background. There was a war that's taking place, and one thing we know about God's chosen people, one thing we know about Israel, they've always been at war. Someone is always coming after them. Even today, someone is coming after Israel. Well, if we go back into history and the story that I'm going to share today, it was the Syrians who were actually attacking Israel. But there was a problem. Every time they would go after Israel, every time they would come up with a plan, there was this guy, maybe some of you have heard of, his name is Elijah, with an S. And every time the Syrians would come up with a plan to attack Israel, Elijah would go to Israel's king and he would basically say, hey, this is what's happening. Here's the plan. I want you to be aware of what the Syrians are about to do. And so Israel would be prepared and they wouldn't fall for the Syrians' trick. And as a result of Elijah going to the king of Syria was furious because he spoiled his battle plan time and time and time again. So the king wanted some answers. He wanted to know, how is Israel finding out our plans? Who is betraying us? And when he found out, there was a man named Elisha who was a prophet who followed in the footprints of Elijah with a J. He was furious and he wanted to take Elijah out. He wanted to do whatever he could to take this man out. So the Syrian king sent men to seize Elijah. And when they got there, Elijah just began praying and asking the Lord to intervene. And Elijah has done some pretty cool things. And I want to encourage you to get into the book of Kings. That's where we're going to be today. And read some of the things that Elijah has done. Some of the things that the Lord has done through Elijah. But when the Syrian army got there to take Elijah, Elijah just began praying to the Lord. And the entire army was blinded. And this is what I love about the story. He leads them in the middle of Samaria. And shortly after, they could see, here they are in the middle of Samaria, surrounded by Israel's army. As a result, the king of Israel now goes to Elijah and says, what shall we do? Shall we kill them? This is our opportunity to end this once and for all. Shall we just get rid of them? We can annihilate them now. You've led them into our hands. And here was Elijah's response. He says, no way. We don't do that. We don't act the way the rest of the world acts. In fact, he says, here's what I want you to do. I want you to feed them. I want you to give them water. And I want you to send them back home. Which is exactly what the king of Israel did. And as a result, Israel experienced peace for a short season. Which brings us to 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 24. Would you bow your heads as we turn there? I want to just pray over the service this morning. I want to thank Holy Spirit for being present. I want to thank our Father for the word that doesn't return void. Lord, I thank you that you brought us all here today to hear a powerful message. And Lord, I pray that through a messed up story like the one we're about to read, that we can come out of here hopeful, that if God can do something powerful in these individual lives, that if God can do something powerful in someone who is so messed up, that he can absolutely do something powerful in our lives. And so may we leave here today filled with hope and courage, knowing that our God loves us, that our God hasn't given up on us, and that maybe the real reason we're here today is that he wants us to know everything is going to be okay. He wants us to know that he's never left us, that he's right here with us. Thank you for being that type of God. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 24. If you're new today, if you're watching online today, normally we have this on YouVersion, and normally we have all kinds of notes, and we have PowerPoint slides. But for this series, I wanted to do something a little different. I wanted to encourage you to write your own notes. Wanted to encourage you to just listen to the story and open up your Bibles. And so I tried to take away every distraction that I could possibly take away. And I know some of you aren't real big fans of it. We'll go back to notes in a few weeks. But at least for now, let's read the story together. 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 24. Sometime later, however, King Ben-Hadad of Aram mustered his entire army and besieged Samaria. They were at peace. Things were going well. But that didn't last very long because the king of Syria was back at his old tricks. Verse 25. And as a result, there was a great famine, unlike any other that this city had saw. The siege lasted so long that a donkey's head sold for 80 pieces of silver, and a cup of dove's dung sold for 5 pieces of silver. Now, you need to hear this morning. One of the ways that they would defeat the enemy is specifically when you were dealing with a city like Samaria that had this fortified wall, one of the ways that you would defeat them is by surrounding them on the outside and not allowing any supplies to go in. And so once you surrounded them and took care and seized the outside, all you really had to do was wait. Eventually, there's no food. Eventually, depending on their water system, there's no water. Eventually, they're going to have to come out. And that's what was taking place. The Syrian army surrounded Samaria, and they waited it out. They cut off all supplies, and eventually they ran out of food. Now, let me tell you this. You know things aren't going well. You absolutely know things aren't going well when a cup of dove poop costs 5 pieces of silver. You know things aren't going well when a donkey's head, which was unclean, the Israelites shouldn't have even thought about eating donkey's head. It was unclean. Yes, donkey's head. Gross, right? It's what I think. You know, it's bad when you're left paying 80 pieces of silver for a donkey's head. But that's how desperate they had gotten. Now, I know we've been through some hard times, but until you're eating donkey's head and drinking dove poop, it ain't too bad, let me just say. We've been through some hard times, but never have I been through something that difficult. One of the reasons I believe that Israel experienced this physical famine because they were actually going through a spiritual famine. Let me say that again. One of the reasons, and I believe one of the reasons we go through physical famines is because oftentimes we are finding ourselves in a spiritual famine. And that's exactly what was taking place in this story. They weren't as close to God as what they once were. They weren't doing what the Lord had commanded. They had actually broken their covenant that they had made with God. They were living disobedient lives. And as a result, the spiritual famine led to physical famine. In fact, Amos chapter 8, verse 11 says this, "There's a time that is surely coming, says the sovereign Lord, when I send famine on the land, not a famine of bread or water, but of hearing the words of the Lord." And I believe wholeheartedly we are seeing that played out in front of us today. I believe churches all over our community, all over the world, have been shaken up. Many have walked away. There is a spiritual famine that we're seeing in the church today. And the result, we can make all the excuses we want, but the real reason that there's a spiritual famine taking place is because we are no longer hungry. We are no longer thirsty for Holy Spirit in our lives. In fact, I believe it's possible that maybe you're here today, and if you're honest with yourself, you've been a little dry. In fact, you didn't even want to come this morning. It's just not exciting anymore. do I have to go? Well, I haven't been there for a few weeks, and I know pastor's going to call if I don't show up, so I'm going to do this and check that off. But let's just be honest, if that's the reason you're here, then you're going through a famine. I want our church to hunger and thirst for God's righteousness. I want our church to hunger and thirst for Holy Spirit to just really begin to move and revive us. Verse 26. One day as the king of Israel was walking along the wall of the city, a woman called to him, "Please help me, my lord king." He answered, "If the Lord doesn't help you, what can I do? I have neither food from the threshing floor nor wine from the press to give you." Now, it was custom in those days that the king was supposed to provide for his people. And here is an instance where things had gotten so bad that even the king couldn't provide. Verse 28. But then the king asked, and I think at this time he was just being empathetic. He's like, "Hey, there's nothing I can do, but at least I'll give you a little bit of my time. I want to hear your story. Tell me what's going on." Verse 28, but then the king asked, "What is the matter?" And here's her reply. "This woman said to me, 'Come on, let's eat your son today. Then we will eat my son tomorrow.' So we cooked my son, and we ate him." And then the next day I said to her, "Kill your son so we can eat him." But she has hidden her son. Things were so bad. So bad inside the walls of Samaria. People were actually starving to death. And they were boiling their babies just so that they could stay alive. And some of you are saying, "Well, how do you know they were babies?" Well, I don't, but I believe it was because if they would have boiled someone like me, they would have had enough food to last a month. There's benefits to being big. I'm big enough to feed this whole church. Things have gotten so bad. I know some of us are going through some difficult times, and I want to be empathetic to that. But I also want you to hear this. You're not the only one who has experienced hard times. In fact, if we were making some points and you wanted to write something down, you could write down this. Sometimes bad things happen. Sometimes bad things happen even to God's children. In fact, we see that all around us. We know people who love Jesus, who are passionate about sharing their faith, and yet they too have bad things happen to them. We know people that maybe they lost a job, or maybe they're going through a financial hardship, or maybe they've went through a messy relationship that ended up in divorce. We know people who get sick, and we know people that are involved in crazy accidents, and we know people who even end up dying, and there's no answers. And yet we want answers. And when we look around, we really begin to see just how messy life is. But I think it's important that we're reminded, even in the midst of this, God is still present, God is still faithful, and God still loves you. Even in the midst of what's taking place in Samaria, as bad as it's gotten, these women desperately needed to hear, I know what you've done. I'm not excusing what you've done, but I know you need to hear this. God still loves you. Verse 30. When the king heard this, he tore his clothes in despair. And as the king walked along the wall, the people could see that he was wearing burlap under his robe next to his skin. May God strike me, even kill me, if I don't separate Elijah's head from his shoulders this very day, the king vowed. Elijah was sitting in his house with the elders of Israel when the king sent a messenger to summon him. But before the messenger arrived, Elijah said to the elders, "A murderer has sent a man to cut off my head. When he arrives, shut the door and keep him out. We will soon hear his master's steps following him." Verse 33. While Elijah was still saying this, the messenger arrived, and the king said, "All this misery is from the Lord. Why should I wait for the Lord any longer?" Things were bad. Things were bad in Samaria. Can we just all agree that things were bad? The king is broken. How could this have happened on my watch? A woman comes up and cries out for help, and he's unable to do anything. And so the woman shares her story. Imagine things being that bad that you have to cook your own children to eat. It doesn't get any more horrific than that. Who would even think that? But that's where we're at. The situation in Samaria is so bad that even this sounds like a good idea. Sometimes bad things happen. And after hearing the story, the king does what many have done throughout Israel's history, tears his robe. A sign of grief, sign of pain, sign of mourning. I don't know if you know this, but when Jesus died on the cross, I believe there's a beautiful picture of that temple curtain that separated the most holy place. Something powerful happened that was a message to God's people. That temple curtain was torn in half from the top to the bottom, showing God's grief and mourning for his son. And in this story, the king just can't understand how things got so bad. So here's my next point. When bad things happen, which they will, don't attack, don't lash out, don't go after the person that you think caused this. Because what we see in this story is the king was so broken that he lashed out. And guess who he blamed? The one person who had been by his side this entire time, Elijah. Elijah was the one who constantly went to the king and shared with the king Syrians' plan of attack. And now things are so bad and things have turned and he forgot about all the good years. Things are so bad now he's going after and he's attacking Elijah. And he makes this promise. Today, if I don't take Elijah out, if I don't take his head off, then take my life. Can I just say this? Be careful what you ask for. Right? Be careful what we ask for. So the king takes someone or sends someone to actually take Elijah out. He was blaming Elijah for what was happening in Samaria rather than really accepting responsibility for his own failed leadership. And can I just say this? That blame game, like blaming others for what's happening in your life, that's been taking place since the very beginning. We can go back to the garden, right? Adam blamed Eve and Eve blamed the serpent. It's just easier. I'm going to confess, I've been guilty of that. I blamed others for my own shortfalls. I'm not exempt from that. I've done that in my life. 2 Kings chapter 3, I just want to go back. You don't have to turn there. You can write it down if you want. I think tells us exactly what's going on. with Israel. Ahab's son, Jeroboam, became the ruler over Israel in the 18th year of King Jehoshaphat's reign in Judah, and he reigned in Samaria for 12 years. This is the king. This is Israel's king. This is who we're talking about today, right now. Goes on to say, he did what was evil in the Lord's sight, not to the same extent as his father and mother. He at least tore down the sacred pillar of Baal that his father had set up. Nevertheless, he continued in the sins and committed and led the people of Israel to commit. In other words, when he was blaming everyone else, he really should have stopped, paused, looked inward, and saw that he himself was responsible for where Israel found themselves. So I just want to say this. It's easy to blame others. But I'm challenging you today to stop that. Stop saying it's my spouse. Stop saying it's my parents. Stop saying it's my friends. Stop blaming your boss. Stop blaming these people. And we all have people to blame when bad things happen. But I'm challenging you not to be like the king of Israel and blame everyone else, but look within. Look within and ask God to reveal. I'm asking you to take responsibility, something that this king did not do. And I get it. Some of you, maybe you're going through some things right now in our human nature, especially when we're suffering and when we're hurting the most. And I'm not talking about like just a little thing. I'm talking about a big thing. Like, you're hurting right now. Our tendency, our human nature is to lash out at God, which is really what the king was doing when he was lashing out at Elijah. He was taking it out on God. He was blaming God. In fact, can we just maybe take a break during this service? And I just want to ask if you just bow your heads for a second. And I want to ask a question. Who have you been blaming? Who have you been lashing out in your life? Who's hurt you? Who have you been blaming? And whether it was something legitimate that they did or maybe something that you're just blaming for the situation that you're in right now, who is that? I want to pray for you. So if a name came to mind as I asked that question, would you raise your hand? I just want to pray for you right now. You know, I'm not asking you to say who it is. I'm not even asking you to share your story. But if there's someone that came to mind that you've been lashing out to or you've been blaming for a long time or maybe even recently, would you raise your hand? I want to pray for you. Heavenly Father, you see every hand that is raised today. And yet as I look around, myself included, we have all, like sheep, gone astray and wandered from you. We've all allowed Satan at one time or another to take us away from you and to follow our own sinful flesh. And today I'm asking that you would bring us back, that there would be some forgiveness that takes place, that forgiveness represents freedom in our lives, that we're no longer holding that person responsible. If they've hurt us, we're letting it go. If they've been the excuse to justify the sin that we catch ourselves in, then today we're repenting of that and letting it go as well. We're asking for freedom. We're asking for forgiveness. We're asking for healing that can only take place when we cry out to you. In Jesus' name, everyone said, amen. Amen. Sometimes bad things happen, even to God's children. And when they do, don't go on the attack. When they do, don't lash out. Turn to Him. Pursue Him. Seek Him. Fall back in love with Him. Allow Christ to do what only He can do. It'll change your life. It will change your life. Chapter 7, verse 1. Elijah replied, "Listen to this message from the Lord." And remember, Elijah is a prophet. God had given him vision. He'd given him a message to share with his people. And here is the message. I know it's bad right now, but here's the message that Elijah's about to give. This is what the Lord says. Someone needs to underline this verse right now. By this time tomorrow. By this time tomorrow in the markets of Samaria, 6 quarts of choice flour. Choice flour, like the best flour, will only cost 1 piece of silver. By this time tomorrow, 12 quarts of barley grain will only cost 1 piece silver. Can we just all agree that that is so much better than donkey head and dove dew? By this time tomorrow in the marketplace, I'm going to do something so amazing. 6 quarts of choice flour will cost 1 piece of silver. 12 quarts of barley grain will cost 1 piece of silver. Verse 2, the officer assisting the king said to the man of God, "This couldn't happen even if the Lord opened the windows of heaven." In other words, you're off your rockers, Elijah. There's no way this can happen. No way this can happen. But Elijah replied, "You will see it happen with your own eyes, but you will not be able to eat any of it." Can I just say this? Sometimes bad things happen, and when they do, don't lash out, don't attack, don't go after others, because change can happen overnight. This time, tomorrow, all things new. This time, tomorrow, everything that you've been going through is over. This time, tomorrow, you're given a new opportunity. This time, tomorrow, things change. And for those of you who say, "But you don't understand, Pastor," I want to stop you right there real quick. You won't get it. You won't even be able to eat from it. When everyone else is being blessed, tomorrow, because of your doubt, because of your unbelief, you miss out. Be careful. Be careful what you ask for. Change. Change can happen overnight. I don't care how bad it is. I don't care what you're going through. When they thought they couldn't take it any longer, change happened overnight. And now, choice flour, and now barley grain is cheaper than what it's ever been in the history of Israel. How does that happen? How does that happen if it's not God showing up and showing favor? And now it's better. It's better than even before they were surrounded. In 24 hours, everything they knew was about to change. And I believe as a church and as a nation, we too are going to see change. We too are going to see change. I believe change is coming. I don't care how bad it is right now. I believe change is coming. I don't care. I just know we have this hope in Jesus. I believe change is coming. And I believe that change is through the power of the Holy Spirit. I can say this boldly before you. I have lived by this my whole life. I've told my wife every day, tomorrow will be better. Tomorrow will be better. Tomorrow, I don't care how bad it's been. I don't care how broken we were. I don't care what financial issue we were going through. Tomorrow will be better. I'm challenging you to live by that verse. Tomorrow will be better. change can happen by this time tomorrow. And our hope is Jesus, confirmed by the power of Holy Spirit living and dwelling inside of us. We just got to come out of that spiritual famine. In fact, Romans 15:13 says this, I pray that God, the source of our hope, will fill you completely with joy and peace because you trust in Him. And then you will overflow with a confident hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. Verse 3. Now there were four men with leprosy. These men were outcast. These men are considered unclean. These are the people that weren't even allowed inside the city walls because they were so unclean, and people were afraid to be around them because they were afraid that if they were inside the walls, they could get what they had. So they were the lowest of low. Now there were four men with leprosy sitting at the entrance of the city gates. And they thought to themselves, why should we sit here waiting to die? Yes, we're outcast. Yes, we've already been kicked, but why should we sit here waiting to die? We'll starve to death if we stay here. But with the famine in the city, we'll starve to death if we go back. So we might as well go out and surrender to the Syrian army. And if they let us live, so much better it will be. But if they've killed us, we would have died anyway. So at twilight, they set out for the camp of Syria. And when they came to the edge of the camp, no one was there. For the Lord had caused the Syrian army to hear the clatter of speeding chariots and the galloping of horses and the sounds of a great army approaching. And the king of Israel has hired the Hittites and the Egyptians to attack us. And they cried to one another. They panicked and ran into the night, abandoning their tents, horses, donkeys, everything else as they fled for their lives. Everything, all the supplies that was coming into Samaria had been piling up outside the walls of Samaria. And here's what I love about this story. The outcasts, the ones that no one wanted, the ones that no one wanted anything to do with, they're the ones that God sends to discover this beautiful treasure. Verse 8, when the men with leprosy arrived at the edge of camp, they went into the tent one after the other. Eating and drinking, they carried off silver and gold and clothing, and they hid it. And finally, they said to each other, this isn't right. This is a day of good news, and we're not sharing it with anyone. If we wait until morning, some calamity will certainly fall upon us. So come, let us go back and let us tell everyone else. Let us go back and bless those who've cursed us. Let us go back and tell everyone else, even though we're the outcast, even though we've been rejected, let us share with them. Verse 10. So they went back to the city and they told the gatekeepers what had happened. And we went out to the camp and they said, no one was there. The horses and the donkeys were tethered and the tents were all in order. But there wasn't a single person around. Then the gatekeepers shouted the news to the people in the palace. I believe, church, if there was ever a time to get excited, we should be getting excited because tomorrow God is on the move. God is doing something. He chose the unusable, people that no one else wanted, to do something just amazing in their life, which should give us hope, because maybe you're here today and you're thinking, there's no way God could use me. There's no way. I'm the outcast. I want you to hear that that's who God has chosen all throughout Scripture. all throughout Scripture. In fact, if you truly are the outcast, you have a better chance of being used. Verse 12. Then the king got up out of his bed in the middle of the night and told his officers, "I know what has happened. The Syrians know we're starving. So they have left their camp and hidden in their fields. They're expecting us to leave the city. And then they will take us alive and capture the city." And one of his officers replied, "Well, we better send out scouts to check this land. Let them take 5 of the remaining horses. If something happens to them, it will be no worse than if they stay here and die with the rest of us." So the 2 chariots with horses were prepared, and the king sent scouts to see what was happening, what had happened to the Syrian army. They went all the way to the Jordan River and followed a trail of clothing and equipment that the Syrians had thrown away in their mad rush to escape. The scouts returned and told the king about it. Then the people of Samaria rushed out and plundered the Syrian camp. So it was true. 6 quarts of choice flour were sold that day for 1 piece of silver. So it was true. 12 quarts of barley grain were sold for 1 piece of silver, just as the Lord had promised through the prophet Elijah. It was true. Then the king appointed his officer to control the traffic at the gate. But he was knocked down and trampled to death as the people rushed out. King made it clear, if I don't take out Elijah today, take out my life. If I don't end this man's life today, take out mine. And sure enough, verse 17, he was trampled to death by his own people. I want to invite our worship team to come back up. And as they're coming back up, I just want to finish the story. So everything happened exactly as the man of God had predicted when the king came to his house. The man of God had said to the king, "By this time tomorrow, in the marketplace of Samaria, 6 quarts of choice flour will cost 1 piece of silver, and 12 quarts of barley grain will cost 1 piece of silver." The king's officer had replied, "That couldn't happen even if the Lord opened the windows of heaven." And the man of God had said, "You will see it happen with your own eyes, but you will not be able to eat any of it." And so it was. For the people trampled him to death at the gate as well. Would you bow your heads? We're going to dim the lights and just reflect. If you're here today and things haven't been going well, if you're here today and you've been struggling spiritually, you've been malnourished. Spiritually, you're just hanging on by thread. And for some of us, that spiritual famine will lead into physical famine. If you're here today and you're going through that, would you raise your hand? I want to pray with you. And as I see hands going up all over the sanctuary, and I know people watching at home, your hands are going up. Can I just say something to you? Tomorrow's coming. Tomorrow is coming. Your answer is coming. Can I pray for you? Can we pray together? Father, you see our hands. And this year, in particular, has been unlike any year we've experienced. This year has been more difficult than we ever thought it would be. We had no idea what was happening this year. And many of us are hanging on by a thread. Today, our hands are lifted up, and we simply cry out and we say, we need you. Your word makes it very clear that you'll never leave us, that you'll never forsake us. And just as we see in this story how you showed up in Israel's life, we're asking that you show up in our lives, that tomorrow things change. Tomorrow things look a little better. Tomorrow we're going to see you move in ways that we never thought was possible. And I'm here today because I know, I trust that you're still on the throne, that you're still sovereign, that you're still in control. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for not giving up on us. In Jesus' name, everyone said, amen. Now I know there are some of you, you've already had your tomorrow moment. This week, there are some of you, you've already had that tomorrow moment. And if that's you, can I just encourage you to share your story? Share your story with someone else. Let them know how good God has been. Let them know how God is moving in your lives. Thank you so much for being here. We're gonna close by singing one last song. And as we sing this song, I'm challenging you to raise your voices and sing to the King. Let him know how much you love them and be filled before you leave today. Stand to your feet. Let's sing this last song.